Hukum for lowering the gaze. In ayah number 30, it was mentioned for men first. Then in ayah number 31, Suratul Nur, for the woman. So this has been mentioned, and let's see the detail of ayah number 31 first, and then we'll go back to ayah number 30 also so that we can understand in a better manner. So ayah number 31, it talks about وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَقْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُورِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ. So till here, I'm going to explain the translation and we'll go in the detail. And say to the believing woman that they must lower their gaze and guard their private parts and must not expose their adornment except that which appear thereof, must wrap their chest, they must cover their chest also, or their fathers, and list of people has been mentioned. So here the mahram relations has been mentioned, like in front of them without hijab, and just we can come in a normal way. That's what it mentioned, must not expose their adornment except their husband or their fathers or fathers of their husband or to their sons or the sons of their husband, so on so forth. So here list of people has been mentioned, like those who are mahram. So what are the relations? And tell the believing woman to lowering their gaze and protect their private parts and not to show off their adornment except that which is apparent, and to draw their veils all over their juyub and not to reveal their adornment except to their husband or their husbands or their husband's father. Means your husband, of course, he's a mahram, and also husband's father is also mahram, or their husband's father, or their and your father too, of course, and or their sons or their husband's sons or their brothers or their brother's sons or their sister's sons or their woman or their right hand possess. So try to understand, like, you know, your brother and sister sons, they are mahram to you, but your husband's brother and sister, they are not mahram to you, they are non-mahram. And or tabin, among men who do not have desire, tabin, or children who are not aware of the nakedness of the woman, means they doesn't understand the private parts and so on and so forth. And let them not stamp their feet. In the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned not to stamp their feet so as to reveal what they hide of their adornment. And all of you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you all. Means here asking or begging Allah to forgive all, O believers, that you may be successful. So in ayah number 30, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned to the believing men. And now it's mentioned for the believing women. So in ayah number 30, it was mentioned, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَقُدُّوا, and tell the believing men to lower their gaze and protect their private parts. There also it's mentioned to protect their private parts. And that is purer for them. Allah is all aware what they do. But what is the additional hukum here for women to cover their private part? That also mentioned for the men, but here covering their aura, that is mentioned over here. So let's see the detail of this, what it says. So here let's understand few things. So yaquddu means is from yaquduna, is from ghad, which is lower. Ghadda is to shorten, to reduce something. And ghad of the eyes to wrinkle the eyelids. This also reduce the vision. Here it means to reduce the vision. The men are being instructed to reduce first their vision. Then they see women, lower their gaze. This is in ayah number 30. Why I'm referring ayah number 30? Because we could understand 31 in a better manner. So min absarihim means from their vision, some of their vision. So they are not supposed to look at which is unlawful though. look at. They may see a woman, but they should not glare and stare. They can look down or not look directly at the woman and guard their private parts. That is mentioned in ayah number 30. And here also it says, and guard their private parts because that is purer for them. This is the hukum for the men. If they keep staring, it's not good for their iman, their hearts. In order to purify their heart, they must shorten their glance. So lowering the gaze, restraining the gaze and not allowing it to wander and dwell on something like stare. There are two categories that should not be looked at. Aura. Aura means the part of the body which should not be exposed. It should be covered. You understand? And they, ayah is addressing men. For example, if he sees a woman, thigh, he must lower his glance, not looking at her. He must turn away. People's house and things which are behind closed doors. Someone must not look through someone's car window, through the windows of one's home. One knocks on someone's door, they must not peer through the glass. That also. So many evil action originates from the eyes looking. If we persist in looking at the unlawful, we are taking a step towards evil. So the wisdom behind the command is to keep the man protect from zina. So here, hadith, the glance is one of the poisonous arrows of shaitan. The evil starts with one look and ends up with more sin. Hadith, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, O Ali, do not follow the first gaze with the second one. This means that if you see something forbidden, the first glance, blink, don't look again. The first is forgiven as it was unintentional, you know, just you looked at it, but the second glance is not. And Hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised the companions, don't hang out in the streets where people are walking. They said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we don't have any alternative where we meet, talk with others. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam give the streets their rights by lowering your gaze. The greeting of salam, enjoin what is right and forbid what is wrong. So we must do what is in our control. So one should guard, we shouldn't look. We already did ayah number 30, just a reminder. But what we learn in ayah number 31, there are few things in ayah number 31, that series of things has been mentioned here. First of all, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. Because of the ta, it is for the believing woman. And يَقْدُدْنَا, and they should lower. So let's see the detail of this meanings. Okay. So women are now told to lower their gaze and guard their private parts. So they must refrain from looking at the private parts or the private matters of the others. Hadith, this is in Muslim, a man should not look at the nakedness of another man, and a woman should not look at the nakedness of the another woman. So when you are going to gym, when you are going for the, like, you know, anything which is girl, like, you know, many sisters, they go for swimming and they are having for the women's day, there also one should not look the private parts of the others. Looking with the desire at body parts, one must lower their gaze. Second, looking without desire or enjoyment, that is okay. Like, you know, you had the glance, but you realize and you lower your gaze. Aisha radiallahu anha was looking at the men performing the show. Men and women have been told to lower the gaze when looking at the opposite gender. We must guard ourselves from such fitna. We are not meant to be looking pleasure for others. So women must also guard their private parts. First, from exposing them, the aura. The aura for a woman in front of a woman is different than in front of men. Second, from committing haram, with them. The aura of a woman in front of another woman is at minimum from the navel to the knee. And here, Vala Yubdina Zinatahunna, women have been told not to reveal their adornment. So, Ibda means to reveal, expose. Two types of Zina. Zina Badaniya. You have to understand this. Zina Badaniya. Women have parts of their body which is innately beautiful. Their hair, lips, their necks. Second thing, adornment which you put on yourself. Like women should not display and flaunt their Zina except that which is apparent, that which is visible on its own. You can't hide, such as height, delicate hands, simple jewelry, her feet. Only the individual can determine what is apparent, what is not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows our intention, niya. And they should place their headscarf on their chest. Khumur is the plural of qimar, the piece of cloth that is worn on the head. Juyub is the plural of jaib, chest. They must put their khimar on their chest to cover it, to conceal it. The khimar should not be worn in such a way to highlight the chest. Part of the arms must be covered in order to cover the chest. Bu'ul is plural of baal. Baal means husband. The husband has the most right to see you beautiful, not the woman in your friend circle show your beauty to your husband. Okay, not the friends. Like, you know, usually we prefer getting ourselves dressed and going out, and then before husband look at us, we change our dress. We are supposed to beautify ourselves. The first and foremost should be husband, and we are giving the least priority, and we are giving priority to our friend circle and to the people to whom we are going to. A woman may display her zina to husband, sons, grandsons, father, grandfather, including maternal, patronal. Okay, father-in-law, son-in-law, this is, you have to be careful. There are certain limits to it. And son of husband, stepsons, brothers, son of their brothers or sisters. Your nephews, you can, but not husband's nephews. They are non-mahram. And they are women who are reliable. In women also reliable, trustworthy, one who understand the concept of hijab. Women who they are comfortable with. And ninth thing, those whom their right hand possess, means male slaves. And tabi'in, their followers or dependent men. So this you have to understand. Those men who follow others and completely dependent. This man must not have desire. For example, although a man in a wheelchair may not be mobile, he still most likely has desire. One may not have desire because he's extremely old or because he has mental disabilities. Just because a man is old does not mean that he does not have desire. Remember this. Many people, they misunderstand this. They think, oh, that's the old person. He's like uncle to me. And sometimes even the youngsters, like you and them, just they are 10 years younger or so on and so forth. And you think, oh, I'm older. Older doesn't guarantee you. So you have to be careful. Little boys, children who have not come to know about private matters of women. Like, you know, they don't know what private matters, what private thingies, and you know. And if a man was nursed by the same woman as you were, he's now your mahram. Father-in-law, son-in-laws are mahram. However, your son or daughter, father's in not mahram. So here you have to understand, somebody nurse you, she's like mother to you. You understand, that is a mahram. And also, like, here list of relations has mentioned, adab of hijab has been mentioned, you know, proper adab, hijab must be adhered to in front of husband's brother. So also mentioned in this ayah is that women should not strike their feet in such a way that it becomes known what is hiding of their adornment. We must watch how we walk. Are we walking in a way that would display some of our zina? If we wear shoes that announce our coming, that is not appropriate. So Allah says, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses all of the believers and tell us to tubu, turn back to Allah, make a U-turn so that they be successful. So here in these details, when Allah is saying, telling believing women to reduce some of their vision and guard their private parts and not to expose their adornment, the ruling of hijab, there is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to believing women. And jealousy on his part over the wives of his believing servant, it is also distinguished the believing woman from the woman of Jahalia and deeds of the pagan woman. The reason for revelation of this ayah was mentioned by Muqtil bin Hayyan, when he said, we heard Allah knows best, Hayyan, when he said, we heard Allah knows best, the Jabir bin Abdullah al-Ansari narrated that Asma binte Mushardi was in a house of hers in Bani Harisa. And the woman stated coming into her without lower garments, that the ankles on their feet could be seen along with their chest and forelocks. Asma said, how ugly this is. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this. وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَقْدُدْنَا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ. And tell the believing women to lower their gaze. And Allah says, and tell the believing women to lower their gaze. And in this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, meaning from that which Allah has forbidden, then to look at the apart from their husband. Some scholars said it is permissible for a woman to look at non-mahram men without desire. It was recorded in Sahih that Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was watching Ethiopian plain with spears in masjid on the day of Eid. So they were watching, you understand? Like you are listening to a lecture and you see him, look at him, but you don't have that bad intention. So in that sense, it's talking about. So that was the thing mentioned over here. And believers was watched them from behind him, and he was concealing her from them until she got bored and went away. So this is the hadith mentioned, and protect their private parts. So Sa'id bin Juhair said, from immoral action, Abu al-Aliya said, every ayah of the Quran in which this is mentioned. So what it is mentioned here, it says one has to protect every ayah of Quran in which protecting the private parts is mentioned, meaning protecting them from zina, except for this ayah. وَيَحْفَزْنَا فُرُوجَهُنَّ means protect their private parts, which means protecting them from being seen by anybody. And وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا زَهَرَ مِنْهَا, and not to show their adornment except that which is apparent. You know, it is zahir, apparent, means they should not show anything of their adornment to non-mahram men except for whatever it is impossible to hide. Ibn Masud said, such as clothes, outer garments, meaning what the Arab women used to wear of the veil, which covered their clothes, and whatever showed from underneath the outer garment, there is no blame on her for this, because this is something that she cannot conceal. Similar to that, what appears of their lower garment and what she cannot conceal. You understand, you are wearing a abaya, and something like while buying something, somebody can see your bangle or your watch, or you have henna on your hand, it is seen, that's okay. But your intention is not that way. And draw their veils all over their jiyub, means they should wear the outer garment in such a way as to cover their chest and ribs, so that they may be different from the women of Jahalia. who did not do that but would pass in front of men with their chest completely uncovered and with their necks, forelocks, hair and earrings uncovered. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the believing women to cover themselves, as he says, Surah number 33, ayah number 59. Ya ayyuhan nabi qul lil azwajika wa banatika wa nisa'il mu'minina yubdina alayhinna min jalabihinna zalika adna an yu'rafna fala yudain. So this is mentioned in Surah Al-Ahzab. So O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tell your wives, your daughters and the women of the believers to draw their cloaks, covering all over their bodies. They will be better that they should be known so as to be annoyed. So in this ayah, وَلَيَدْرِبْنَا بِخُمُورِهِنَّ عَلَىٰ جُيُوبِ. Khumur is from khimar and this is used for alcohol also. When you drink alcohol, it will cover your sense. You don't know what you are doing. So this is like covering. Covering where? Yeah, khimar. This is wore on your head. This is talking about headscarf. So here, khumur, veil, is the plural of khimar, which means something that covers. And what is used to cover the head? This is Sa'id bin Jubair said, and to draw means to pull it around and tie it securely. Their veils all over their juyub, means all over their necks, chest, so that nothing can be seen of them. Al-Bukhari recorded, Aisha radiallahu anha, may Allah be pleased with her, said, may Allah have mercy on the women of the early immigrants when Allah revealed this ayah, and to draw their veils all over their jayb. They tore their aprons, aftamar, themselves with them. He also narrated from Safiya bint Shayban that Aisha radiallahu anha said, used to say, when the ayah wal yadribna bihumurihinna ala juyubihin, and to draw their veils all over their juyub was revealed, they took their izar, waist sheet, and tore them at the edges, and aftamar themselves with them. So, and not to reveal the adornment except the following list we have discussed already. And all of those women are close relatives whom she can never marry. You know, non-mahram, you can't go in front of them without hijab and proper covering. Here talking about the mahram. So, the following list already discussed. But what if, like, you know, she may also wear her adornment in front of other Muslim women. But not in front of Muslim women, like, you know, other than Muslim women, Jews and Christians. What happens? Sometimes they go and mention in front of their husband how that woman, how she looks and so on and so forth. Even for the Muslim woman, one should not tell how their friends look, how she is without hijab and so on and so forth. That is forbidden, you know. No woman should describe another woman to her husband so that it as if he is looking at her. We shouldn't do that. And also here mention about the people who don't have any desire for the marriage, and in front of them you can go so on and so forth. Either they are physically, they don't have any desire, the men's, or they are physically handicapped, or, you know, they are not aware of those things. So still they can work around and, you know, they can do their chores. But the basic things you have to take care of. They still, they can work there. And also we see that illa ara haza ya'lamu ma hahuna. Also here it's mentioned the children who are not aware of the private parts and nakedness. In front of them also it's okay to go in front of them. And also what the etiquettes of women walking in the street. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا يَبْدْرِبْنَا بِأَرْجُلِهِنَّ, and let them not stamp their feet. So during Jahaliyah, when women walked in the street wearing anklets, no one could hear them. They would stamp their feet so that men could hear their anklets ringing. Allah forbid the women to do this. So that's the reason not to stamp their feet, you know, especially when we wear high heels, we stamp our feet. So we should avoid such kind. And also mention, you know, not to wear perfume when you go out. In this, it's not mentioned, but there is a hadith in that it's mentioned not to wear perfume when you go out. And also it says, every eye commits fornication and adultery. And when a woman puts on perfume and passes through a gathering, she is such and such, meaning an adulteress. So this is a wa'id, you know, warning for them. So these are the things we learn from ayah number 31. So one should protect our, lower our gaze, and one should cover ourselves, whether you cover with the jilbab, abaya, or you take any shawl. You have to cover your bosom. You have to cover yourself properly, your head, and also your chest, lowering your gaze. It doesn't mean you are wearing niqab, covering oneself, and you are looking non-mahram. That is also not allowed. And list of mahram people are mentioned. And of course, husband is very close. You can show your zina to husband. That is the closest person. But other than husband, like people, they think wearing skinny jeans, tight clothes, or see-through. Also in front of mahram also, you have to be careful. You have to be in a modesty way. The only thing, you don't have to take the headscarf in front of mahram, like, you know, brother, sons, or your own children. But you have to be dressed up in a modesty. These are the avenues which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala closed, which direct towards the zina or immodesty. Jazakallah khairan kaseera.